Tonight on NewsWatch, will the U.S. step up in Syria? We'll look at the president's red line and America's response to the civil war.
Plus, National Day of Prayer. Why some say calling on God is the only way to change America.
And CBN News sits down with Tea Party favorite Senator Ted Cruz. All this and more tonight on NewsWatch. The world is watching to see what the U.S. does in Syria. Good evening. I'm Mark Martin.
And I'm Wendy Griffith. America isn't the only country deciding what action to take in the Middle East. Israel also has to decide if it will take military action against Iran. Chris Mitchell has our story from Jerusalem.
Syrian opposition groups released this video showing what they say are some of the dozens of people killed or sickened in a chemical weapons attack by the Assad government. Back in March, President Obama issued a warning.
To use potential weapons of mass destruction on civilian populations crosses another line, and that is going to be a game changer.
Since then, British, French, and Israeli intelligence all concluded that the Assad government did conduct a chemical attack. And last week, Defense Secretary Chuck Hagel agreed. But the White House is reluctant to call it a game changer for the U.S. in Syria.
Now, we are working to establish credible and corroborated facts to build on this intelligence assessment in order to establish a definitive judgment as to whether or not the president's red line has been crossed and to inform our decision-making about next steps.
Israeli Middle East analyst Jonathan Speier says both U.S. friends and foes in the region are watching.
It's now very apparent that the regime has used chemical weapons on a number of occasions, which means that if the United States now fails to act on its clear red line, then of course conclusions will be drawn in that regard by all other players in the region, including some players very hostile to the United States, such as Iran.
One option in the U.S. arsenal, strikes from the air or sea on the Syrian chemical weapons facilities and production plants scattered throughout the country. But that is a subject the administration won't address in the media. President Obama's red line on Syria is a big enough problem for the Middle East, but here in Jerusalem, Prime Minister Netanyahu has to deal with an even more dangerous red line, the one leading to a nuclear Iran.
A red line should be drawn right here. Before Iran completes the second stage of nuclear enrichment necessary to make a bomb.
Just months after Netanyahu's red line speech to the UN last fall, former Israeli military intelligence chief Amos Yadlin said that Iran has now crossed that red line, or is at least right at the threshold. The U.S. red line involves Iran actually building a weapon, while the Israeli red line tries to prevent Iran from getting nuclear capability, and before it reaches the breakout stage of producing a weapon.
The red line has been crossed. A lot now depends on the Iranian decision in this regard, and certainly Israel will be watching very, very carefully.
So, while Western governments debate what they might do, Israel is strengthening its defenses in the Golan Heights, on a border with Syria that has been mostly quiet for 40 years, because the red lines being talked about now in Washington appear to lead straight to Israel's borders. Chris Mitchell, CBN News, Jerusalem.
While much of the U.S. was focused on violence in Syria and Boston last month, attacks were soaring in Iraq. The United Nations is now reporting that April was the deadliest month there since June of 2008. In a report out today, the UN says attacks killed 712 people in Iraq in April, and that includes 117 members of Iraqi security forces. Interestingly, the Associated Press has a different number, recording only 400 deaths last month. Experts say casualty tolls vary because official reports often differ from local police and hospital accounts. Nevertheless, the numbers underscore a growing concern that security is rapidly deteriorating in Iraq.
And joining us now is Dr. Waleed Faris. He's the author of the book, The Coming Revolution, The Struggle for Freedom in the Middle East. Waleed, some say that the situation in Syria is similar to the one in Iraq before the U.S. invasion there. Do you see that comparison?
Yes, of course. It is similar in the sense that there is a confrontation between two camps now. One is the regime, which is backed in this case by Iran and Hezbollah. And then you have the opposition, and the opposition has two components. One is secular, and the other one is Islamist and jihadist. And one other similarity are the Christian minorities and other ethnic minorities. They have suffered in Iraq, and they are now suffering in Syria. The difference is that there are no foreign forces, there are no American forces or NATO forces ready to invade Syria in this case. That's why the conflict seems to be, you know, getting longer and longer on the ground.
Waleed, now with the talk that chemical weapons might be involved in Syria, how much U.S. involvement do you think should take place in Syria?
The Obama administration, unfortunately, missed to act in Syria when it had the capacity of our troops in Iraq. We withdrew from Iraq at the end of 2011 without dealing with the Assad regime. So now, since 2012 and over the past few months, Iran, through Iraq, has been supporting the Assad regime. Hezbollah, through Lebanon, has been intervening in Syria. And unfortunately, Al-Qaeda and jihadi-linked groups are now making progress within the opposition. So what can the United States do now is going to be very difficult, because we lack a regional alliance with us that is ready to move with us. And most importantly, we lack a partner within the Syrian opposition. We have not identified the secular moderate element so far and supported them.
Now, there is some worry that the aid money given to rebels will fall into the hands of extremists from Hezbollah or Al-Qaeda. Is that a legitimate threat?
It's a very legitimate threat. If we throw the aid to Syrian opposition without making sure that we have identified who is with us, who are our partners, what is their project for the future, we may end up arming either Hezbollah on the one hand or Al-Qaeda on the other hand, as you said.
Do you think there's an end in sight to the civil war?
The fight, and this is bad news, may get also into Iraq and into Lebanon by the same forces fighting in Syria. And thirdly, there may be regions now seceding in Syria. If Damascus falls, Assad is not going to quit Syria. He's going to go to the Alawi land in the northwest. So it's a long, protracted conflict, as long as the administration did not make a choice to intervene firmly.
All right. Waleed Faris, we thanks so much for being with us today.
Thank you for having me.
A Korean American has been sentenced to 15 years hard labor in a North Korean prison. Kenneth Bae of Washington State was arrested in November near the border of China and Russia. He's accused of committing what North Korea describes as hostile acts against the state. He's the sixth American held there since 2009. Friends and colleagues say Bae is a devout Christian. He frequently traveled to North Korea to feed orphans. It's believed his sentencing is nothing more than a political ploy by the North Korean regime. One leading analyst says they're using Bae as a pawn to get a high-profile American to visit the country and build up the image of North Korean leader Kim Jong-un.
The surviving suspect in the Boston Marathon bombing bragged that he knew how to build a bomb just a month before the deadly attacks. Now, three of Johar Tsarnaev's friends are being charged. They're accused of removing evidence, lying to investigators, and obstructing justice. Charlene Israel has the story.
It's a cover-up that started with a text message. The FBI says two 19-year-olds, Asmaitov Zayakov and Dias Katerbayev, recognized their college friend Johar Tsarnaev from surveillance photos on television. One of the teens texted Tsarnaev to ask if he was the bomber. His response, LOL, laughing out loud. Then he texted, come to my room and take whatever you want. According to the FBI, the two friends took a backpack and hollowed out fireworks and a computer. They then threw them in a dumpster behind their apartment. Wednesday, their lawyers were in federal court denying they did anything wrong.
They did not intentionally or knowingly destroy evidence.
He has cooperated fully with the authorities and looks forward to the truth coming out in this case.
The two young men from Kazakhstan are in the United States on student visas. But federal law enforcement officials say Tzayakov's visa was terminated in January after he was academically dismissed from the University of Massachusetts, Dartmouth. Despite not having a valid student visa, he was still allowed to re-enter the U.S. Officials say the two are not accused of actually being involved in the attack. But court papers show one suspect told investigators Tsarnaev bragged about knowing how to make a bomb nearly a month before the Boston attacks. The third person arrested, Robel Philippos, was a high school friend of Tsarnaev. He's charged with lying to investigators. Tsarnaev's friends face 5 to 8 years in prison if convicted and a $250,000 fine. Charlene Israel, CBN News.
The Justice Department is appealing a judge's decision to lift all age limits on the so-called morning after birth control pill. The federal government says the judge exceeded his authority. They want his decision suspended while the appeal is underway. U.S. District Judge Edward Corman of New York mandated that emergency contraception be available on store shelves to anyone, no matter how young they are. He said drugs like the Plan B pill should be sold just like aspirin.
Today marked the 62nd annual National Day of Prayer. Millions of Americans from coast to coast participated, but the main event took place in the halls of the United States Capitol. John Jessup was there.
And forgive us, mighty God.
From near and far.
We flew in from LAX airport in Los Angeles.
I'm from Calvary Christian School, which is a small private school in Old Bridge, New Jersey.
People packed into the U.S. Capitol in Washington to pray for America, the motto for this year's annual observance. Lord, you are holy, holy. It started 62 years ago here in the States, and organizers say it's now grown to include more than 42,000 prayer gatherings across the country. In this crowd, some familiar faces like Vonette Bright, James and Shirley Dobson, and the legendary Pat Boone.
God, we cry out to you.
Together, they prayed for repentance, for blessing, and for our leaders in the military and the judicial, legislative, and executive branches of government, all of which were represented. Barry Black, chaplain of the Senate, urged people to stop praying for just themselves and to start praying for their leaders, even if they disagree with their politics.
Pray for all people because our blessed Lord desires all men and women to be saved.
Many voiced concerns about a culture slipping further away from its Christian roots, a topic addressed by keynote speaker Greg Laurie, pastor of Harvest Christian Fellowship.
Revive your work as you did in days gone by. Show us your power to save us. And that's what we need to pray, Lord. Do it again.
But gay rights activists denounced Laurie's participation, citing his, quote, blatantly anti-LGBT message and calling it, quote, out of step with what the majority of people of faith across the country believe. But supporters say Laurie's only guilty of preaching the Bible.
In spite of what they see, people here say they have hope because of prayer and they look forward to the future and coming back together to pray again this time next year. John Jessup, CBN News, Capitol Hill.
Coming up, how a horse race is leading to a rise in human trafficking.
Ow, my feet hurt.
My feet hurt, your feet hurt. White hot pain, I wanna cry. Is there anything I can try?
Why, yes. Introducing Strut Soul Angels, the human shock absorber that helps alleviate foot pain.
The first 10 steps in the morning to the bathroom were excruciating. Within 3 days after I put Struts on, it's been such a relief.
Slipped it on and almost immediately I felt a support, kind of like a pillow underneath my arches.
The Struts Soul Angel provides a great amount of relief and support throughout the course of the day, providing shock absorption and relief of pain.
On your feet without proper support can be painful. Strut Soul Angels promotes better balance, control, and body alignment. Standing in your heels all day is painful, but slip on Struts and you'll enjoy comfort and support 24/7. Struts is so versatile, you'll wear them in every shoe you own, even barefoot.
I'm on my feet all the time. I teach 11 and 12 year olds. The pain was so much that I knew I had to do something. And with the Struts, I can do my job and enjoy my job.
I usually am on my feet from 8 to 12 hours a day. When I wear my Struts, it's like giving my feet a hug all day.
It's life changing. I wear them from the minute I get up to the minute I go to bed.
Why pay $400 for custom orthotics?
Now get Strut Soul Angels for just $10. You also get Miracle Foot Repair Cream, absolutely free. Use it to help relieve dry, calloused feet overnight. But wait, call right now and we'll double the offer free. Just pay separate processing and handling. Plus, you get a 100% money-back guarantee. If not completely delighted, send it back, but keep the foot cream as our gift just for trying. You get it all, a $70 value for just $10.
Oh, yes!
Love my Struts, the best thing since sliced bread. They heal pain from toes to head. Get yours now, your doctor said.
struts. Be nice to your feet. Call now.
Call 1-800-787-1580 and get your struts and miracle foot repair for just $10, and we'll double the offer. That's 1-800-787-1580 or visit getstruts.com.
Welcome back. Human trafficking is on the rise in Louisville, Kentucky, of all places. The reason, the Kentucky Derby.
Yeah, criminals try to take advantage of big events like this as many potential customers come to town seeking prostitutes.
The Kentucky Derby is known as the greatest 2 minutes in sports, and for many it evokes the sounds of hoofbeats and my old Kentucky home. To human traffickers, the city and its famous horse race are simply avenues for exploitation.
We have high rates. We have a serious problem.
These pimps, our handlers, look at it as a way of making fast money in a one-day or two-day event, and they're going to double and triple what they normally make. So they'll bring these girls in from all over.
Louisville Metro Police and victims' rights groups monitor websites known for adult escort advertising. They estimate postings on these sites for Louisville have tripled this week leading up to the Kentucky Derby.
And before Keeneland Spring Meet and before the Derby, women and what we believe to be our children are advertised as fillies and mustangs.
Sergeant Andre Bottoms says the prostitution human trafficking rings are set up in hotels in every part of the Kentucky-Indiana area surrounding Louisville. Bottoms estimates about 10% of the hundreds of prostitutes in Louisville this week are being forced or coerced. After each prostitution arrest, police look for signs of trafficking.
Then we change course, and at that point we treat them as a victim and not a criminal.
Teresa Flores is a survivor of human trafficking. She founded the organization Traffic Free, which helps build awareness through what's called the SOAP outreach. SOAP stands for Save Our Adolescents from Prostitution. At national events like the Kentucky Derby, the outreach program distributes thousands of bars of soap to high-risk motels in the area. The soap is wrapped with a red band that gives the National Human Trafficking Hotline number and asks questions like, are you being forced to do anything you do not want to do?
And write this number down or look it up online. The National Human Trafficking Hotline number is 1-888-373-7888. Volunteers offer the soap free of charge to motel owners and then explain what is happening to young girls in their motels.
Wow. Well, up next, we'll look at the faith of freshman Senator Ted Cruz.
Jim is 38, mortgage, married, three great kids. He wants to protect his family with a $500,000 term life insurance policy. What do you think it'll cost him? $100 a month? $60? $40? Actually, none of the above. Jim can get a $500,000 policy from a highly rated insurer for under $19 a month. His secret? SelectQuote. SelectQuote is impartial. They'll comparison shop the pick of insurance companies like these to give you a choice of your best prices. SelectQuote has great savings on term life for women, too. Jim's wife, Deidre, can get a $500,000 policy for under $16 a month. SelectQuote has helped make term life insurance affordable for hundreds of thousands of people since 1985. How about you? Just call this number or go to SelectQuote.com. SelectQuote. We shop, you save.
Help!
If an emergency happened right now, you can have help at the push of a button with Medical Alert.
Remember when I took that fall, Mary?
Oh, yes, that was terrible.
Yes, it was.
Help!
And I thought, what if you hadn't been there? I ordered my Medical Alert the next day.
I can't describe how safe I feel now with my Medical Alert. You didn't know I was wearing it, did you?
Medical Alert is easy to install, waterproof, and covers you inside your home and out.
It helps me feel safe from fires, break-ins.
And of course, a Medical Alert. And if you don't have a home phone, don't worry. They have that covered.
There's always help at the push of a button. Don't wait till you need it.
Get Medical Alert for less than $1 a day. There are no long-term contracts. Order now and get your second button free. Call for your free brochure.
For your free medical alert system with second button free, call 800-575-8507.
2016 is still a few years away, but it could already be on the mind of freshman Senator Ted Cruz. The Tea Party star may be eyeing a presidential run. The National Review reports Cruz isn't talking publicly about his intentions, but insiders say a run for the White House is definitely on his mind. Well, even though he's fairly new to the Senate, Cruz is already one of the few Republicans being called a potential rock star.
So what makes this Lone Star lawmaker tick? David Brody traveled to Texas for this Focus Report.
Daddy,
want
the money?
I got some money.
This is what truly drives Ted Cruz. Time at home with his wife and daughters in Houston, away from Washington's hustle and bustle.
Diligence, working hard to accomplish a task. Proverbs 22:29 tells us.
Family devotions take priority for the Cruz family, although Daddy faces pretty important work when Mr. Cruz goes to Washington.
They will bear true faith and allegiance to the same.
Since Ted Cruz descended on Washington, he's blazed a pretty remarkable path.
First, thanks be to God. To him be the glory.
Despite a resume that includes Harvard Law School, Cruz started as a political unknown, registering just 2% in the polls. Tea Party backing and a strong message, however, led to a primary win against the GOP lieutenant governor and powered him to the Senate.
It really was breathtaking, and it was a testament to the grassroots. It was a testament to what we the people can do standing together.
The Cruz family is used to overcoming long odds. His Cuban father arrived in the States at age 18, speaking no English, with only $100 to his name. He went from his first job as a dishwasher to regularly working 7 days a week and eventually put himself through college. Now, after decades in business, his father travels as a Baptist pastor.
My dad has been my hero my whole life. But what I've always found most extraordinary about his story is how commonplace it is.
Cruz's career follows an upbringing filled with political discussion around the family table. He even memorized the U.S. Constitution as a super smart high schooler.
I gave probably 80 speeches all over the state on free market economics and the Constitution. And it became really my passion.
In college, Cruz began to connect the Constitution with his Christian faith. His mentor, Princeton professor and conservative Christian Robbie George, helped him embrace the concept of natural law.
Life, liberty, and property, the fundamental natural rights of man, are given to every one of us by God. And the role of government fundamentally is to protect those rights.
That philosophy became central to Cruz's political core.
The left is using the courts of law to tear down our faith.
Cruz, a Southern Baptist, doesn't shy away from talking about his faith.
At the end of the day, faith is not organized religion. It's not going to a church. It is a personal relationship with Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior.
But he's determined not to use it as a weapon.
I think anyone in politics, you've got a special obligation to avoid being a Pharisee, to avoid ostentatiously wrapping yourself in your faith.
Instead, Cruz has taken strong stands against increasing the debt ceiling. John Kerry is Secretary of State, and faced criticism for grilling Defense Secretary nominee Chuck Hagel.
We do not know, for example, if he received compensation for giving paid speeches at extreme or radical groups.
Senator Cruz has gone over the line. He basically has impugned the patriotism of the nominee.
But conservatives applaud his approach. National Review ran the headline, First Class Cruz, the Next Great Conservative Hope. Former Bush strategist Mark McKinnon has called him the Republican Barack Obama.
Look, they're calling you a GOP rock star. What do you think?
I try to pay very little attention to the media. As you know, a fickle creature.
For now, Cruz says he's focused on the job at hand, and that includes a new Republican Party.
I think President Obama is the most radical president we've ever seen. But I think an awful lot of Republicans failed to stand for principle and contributed to getting us in this mess.
You have a dolly bed. Let's go get your dolly bed, okay?
Heidi Cruz knows her husband will stand for principle. And she learned something else about him during that uphill battle for the Senate.
He only got better and better as things got tougher and tougher. And that gave voters and certainly us as his family just a lot of confidence that he's pretty good.
Calm and a strength in the storm is what you're saying.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah.
I'm not sure that assessment is always true around the dinner table.
But it sure is true in national politics. David Brody, CBN News, in Houston, Texas.
Up next, from running to swimming, how one group is giving back to a Boston Marathon bombing victim.
Attention, sleep apnea patients. Are you tired of the expense and hassle of getting your CPAP and BiPAP supplies? Are you fed up with dealing with ill-fitting, leaking, or worn-out masks and straps? Are you worried about the effects that unsanitary tubes, cushions, and filters have on your health? If you said yes to any of these questions, Allied Medical Supply Network has the solution to your problems. You could qualify to have your supplies regularly delivered right to your door at little or no cost to you. That's right, no more inconvenience, no worn-out masks and straps, no more unsanitary equipment, just restful sleep. Call Allied Medical Supply Network today to determine if you may qualify to receive your fresh, brand-name supplies at little or no cost. Don't delay. Call us now to see if you are eligible to save money on regular delivery of your CPAP and BiPAP supplies. Call 1-800-815-9947. That's 1-800-815-9947. Or go to CPAPSupplyHelpline.com.
Announcing an important breakthrough in healthcare that can benefit everyone. If you or anyone you love needs affordable health insurance, regardless of a pre-existing medical condition, call Quick Insurance 123 today and get the immediate relief you deserve. Quick Insurance 123 was created to provide affordable health insurance to all uninsured Americans, with or without pre-existing conditions. This is not a discount card. This is a real insurance program that lets you choose from many affordable health plans, with access to doctors, hospitals, emergency services, and more. So call the number on your screen now and get the health coverage you need, just for calling. As a special bonus, we'll send you a free prescription savings card that could save you up to 85% on your prescriptions. That's right, you could save up to 85% on your prescriptions, just for calling. Call Quick Insurance 123 to find out how you can get affordable health insurance and receive your free prescription savings card, just for calling. Don't wait. Getting a free quote is as easy as 123. Call today.
A North Carolina aquatic center is showing its support for one of the victims of the Boston bombings.
Nicole Gross is from Charlotte, North Carolina, but she's still in a Boston hospital recovering from her injuries. For years, Gross was involved with the Mecklenburg County Aquatic Center as a triathlete coach. This week, people flooded to the complex to participate in the Swim for Nicole fundraiser. Athletes got an hour of training for any donation.
That's what being a competitor is all about, and being a Charlotte athlete and an athlete in general. It's, you help each other. Whether it's you're on a bike ride and you fall, someone's going to stop and help you out. And that's what life is about, and that's what we all hope to strive for.
Gross's injuries included a fractured leg and ankle, and she's still up in that Boston hospital, and we send her our prayers right now in Jesus'
name. Yeah. Great to see that she has that support there.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Really cool.
Well, that's all for this edition of NewsWatch.
Remember, you can email us your comments and questions at newswatch@cbn.com. We'll see you tomorrow. Good night.